Welcome to worship with the First Baptist Church of Middletown, Kentucky. My name is Jim Cobbin, and it's my privilege to welcome you to this time of worship today. You're in for a treat. Our message today is from our own Reverend Gabe Close, our minister of young adults and teenagers, and we welcome his message for us. So we want to encourage you to get your Bible and follow along in the reading. Pray with us, sing with us, join in worship as we meet God here in this holy place. Let's pray together. O God of mercy, light, and life, we run towards you. We are confessing we are not yet what you want us to be, but we fall on your mercy. Today, O Lord, we open our hearts to receive the message through music, through the scripture, and through the sermon that you have for us. In Christ's name, amen.
Blessed Savior, we adore thee.
Redeemer is worthy of all of our praise. We give him the honor that he deserves today as we sing, Worthy of Worship.
Worthy of all of the honor. from Mark chapter 1. Then they went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one having authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in the synagogue who was possessed by an evil spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." And the evil spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching and with authority? He even gives orders to evil spirits and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ our King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a wonderful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ our King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. 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 Jesus.
Thank you, Penny, for that beautiful music. We have spent a couple weeks at the beginning of this new year in the Gospel of Mark. And Dr. Cobbin reminded us several weeks ago that the Gospel of Mark has an immediacy to it. We don't find the birth story of Jesus in the Gospel of Mark like we do in Matthew and in Luke. And instead, we jump right into Jesus's ministry. There's no waiting, there's no guessing. From the get-go, Mark chapter 1 has us in the midst of Jesus' ministry. And in our passage today from verses 21 through 28, Mark is really giving us some other signs, giving us some other examples of who Jesus is. And in this first passage or first part of the passage, he goes to the synagogue. And Jesus reads and teaches in the synagogue. And in those days, the synagogues were centers for teaching, and it was allowed that the leader of the synagogue could name any competent man at that time to preach or to teach. Certainly, those of us maybe who grew up in a small church might be used to having or familiar with having a bivocational minister. And this was kind of the case in the synagogue, right? Think of this as a country church where Jesus is. It's not Jerusalem, the temple with the major leaders, Jewish leaders of the day, who probably got paid a little bit better, who knew all the exact rituals, but others were called on from week to week to speak in the synagogue. And as a young kid, I remember thinking and reading this passage and thinking, well, I guess Jesus, you know, he just read scripture, walked in and read scripture because he's Jesus and he's the Son of God. And if you're the Son of God, you can say, hey, it's my turn to read scripture. And everybody goes, okay, go ahead. Teach, read scripture. But in fact, it was his week, and the leader of the synagogue was open to Jesus speaking. And I think we can take something from this set of customs of the synagogue in Jesus's day. I think about our own church, and I have been in several churches in my life, and some of you may have been in other churches as well. And not every minister is comfortable with sharing the pulpit. We have been fortunate in that Dr. Cobbin, our preacher, has often had guest preachers and able to share a different part of the gospel, a different message, a different perspective with us. Even in our own congregation, Dr. Jim Hunter, Reverend Greg McClellan, just in the last few weeks have preached in this pulpit. In the last couple years, I think of Sister Lorraine from Water with Blessings, Reverend Rhonda Blevins from CBF, who has spoken in this pulpit. Others were invited to speak just as Jesus was this day in the synagogue. And so I hope you'll think about this with me as I share an example with you. So our youth probably know this, and those of you who know me probably know that I love Chuck Taylor tennis shoes. These Converse Chuck Taylors, these are just a few of the several many colorful, some might say too many colorful pairs that I have of Chucks. And they come in all kinds of shapes and sizes and designs, and they are my favorite shoe. A good buddy of mine growing up, he would always buy the high tops. I would always get the low tops. And we'd figure out what kind of crazy designs we could find. And I think he is still in the lead with his pizza Chucks. Yes, he found a pair that looked like slices of pizza. As much as I love Chuck Taylors and have been wearing them since I was a young teenager, I must admit to you that they are not great for every walking, running situation. I know they were designed to be basketball shoes. I've seen the pictures from the 60s and 70s, the NBA players wearing Chuck Taylors, but I've tried playing basketball in Chucks, and they are not good for your arch. They don't have great padding, and they are a great way to turn an ankle. As much as I love them, I don't wear them to play basketball in. And I've spent a few times wearing Chucks when I've been out in the rain or stepped in a puddle. And those canvas Chuck Taylors will constrict and often will cut into the back of your heel if you continue to wear them when they're sopping wet. And as much as I love them, unless I was interviewing for Apple or Google, I probably wouldn't wear them to a job interview. I can see someone sitting across the table or sitting across a desk and saying, "Son, is that what you're going to wear to work? Those shoes?" They don't fit every situation. They're not perfect for everything. As much as I love them, sometimes I need some rain boots. Sometimes I need some basketball shoes. Sometimes I need some dress shoes. Often, what makes us whole people in life, in our faith, is different perspectives that are able to reveal God to us. One perspective, my own, or just one other person I listen to all the time, doesn't always work. I need a variety. Just like, as much as I love Chuck Taylors, wearing them all the time in every situation isn't a great idea. It struck me reading this passage that Jesus is able to speak in the synagogue that day because the synagogue leader is okay with variety, okay with different speakers. If there had been one speaker and only one speaker, one source and only one source to listen to, the people would have missed out on the Savior of the world speaking that day. He wouldn't have been able to speak. But the synagogue leader opened that door for that opportunity. And I think it's a great lesson for us in our life and in our faith. When I think about my own faith, there are so many people who have contributed teaching me about Jesus. It's a reminder for us not to listen to everyone and anyone, believe them willy-nilly, but to say, you know what? There are a lot of people that can teach me different things about Jesus. Jesus speaks in many ways. And because they were open to a different speaker speaking in the synagogue that day, they were able to hear Jesus speak and teach with authority, the scripture says to us. Jesus speaks with authority. There was something different about the way Jesus taught and spoke that day. I'm sure we all know someone who's the authority in their subject or topic. Given the time, I would run down through our whole staff, but I want to highlight our minister of music here. A few years ago, I was working on a song. Some of you know that I play guitar and write music, and I admittedly don't read music very well. I can read guitar charts and can pick out chords a lot of times by ear, but I'm not good with the staff and the bars and all the notes, and not my forte. And so I was working on a song and had several different vocal parts, and I took that song to Leslie and I said, this is kind of what I'm hearing. I played it for her, and this is what I'm thinking here and here. And within a matter of minutes, she had it plotted out. Well, this person needs to sing here, and this one would go here, and that would blend well. Why? Because she's an authority in music. She gets it in a way that many others do not. She gets it in a way that I did not. This is Jesus walking in to teach in the synagogue that day. The people can tell he's an authority. Think about the people you know that are an authority in their topic, in their subject, at their job. There's something that sets them apart. And here the people said, wow, there's something different about the way he teaches. There's something different about the way he reads the scripture. Because he's not just reading it. He's lived it. He's been there. He is the Son of God. It is who he is. And Mark gives us this giant billboard in his story, waving at us, Jesus is different. There's something different about Jesus that he reads with authority. But if that weren't enough, the second part of this passage Mark uses as a sign to us, his readers, as well. The man possessed by an evil spirit, and Jesus approaches this man and is able to drive out the spirit. Dr. Cobbin talked a few weeks ago about the Markan secret, that Jesus waits in the text in the book of Mark to reveal who he is. We'll often see him early in the book say, don't tell others. And that always confused me as a kid because I was taught maybe, perhaps like many of you, that you're always supposed to tell everybody about Jesus all the time. And here is Jesus in the Gospel of Mark saying, no, don't say anything. And I was always very puzzled by that. But it is a trait of the book of Mark. And we may have that at work here. Jesus drives out the demon, the unclean spirit, and the unclean spirit says, I know who you are. But there may be something else at work here. Many scholars think that perhaps the unclean spirit is trying to have some control or exert control over Jesus. It was thought in Jesus' day, if you knew the name of a spirit, then you had dominion or control over it. And perhaps the Spirit is trying to exercise the same thing upon Jesus. And Jesus lets his readers and the people there watching this action know, you don't have control over me. He says, be quiet. And he gives the Spirit directions. It is a sign to us, the reader, a sign to all those watching in his presence, Jesus is different. Jesus is set apart. Jesus has command and is the Son of God here. I'd be remiss if we didn't talk about Jesus' ability to do miracles here in 2021. I think this sometimes trips people up when they come to the scripture. I remember in college and in seminary, people giving all kinds of explanations. Who can do miracles? Who can't? Can we do miracles today? Is it still possible? And all kinds of answers from, well, maybe we don't have enough faith, or perhaps we don't do miracles anymore because we have modern science and medicine. And those are good questions. I certainly don't have the time to resolve them all here. But I want to say to you, I think sometimes when we get caught up in those discussions and those arguments, we miss the miracles in front of our eyes. Jesus is working in these amazing ways and miracles in Scripture. But Jesus is still working in our daily lives, even if it's not a miraculous healing like we find in Scripture so many times. I'm sure many of us watching, many of those in the sanctuary can think of a time that we would say, that was a miracle in my life. Maybe it wasn't a miraculous healing. Maybe a surgery went better than we thought. Maybe somebody reached out in a time of need. And while not exactly like the scripture, the miracles in scripture that we see, it was still very much a miracle in God's presence in our lives. This past summer, our young adult group spent some time in a financial peace class. We were originally going to have that here at the church, and of course, with COVID, decided we would do that on Zoom. And because we were able to do that on Zoom, we had several people from around the country join us, which was wonderful. To have our young adult group here in Louisville and people in several other states join us for this financial peace course. One of the members of the course from another state was really struggling as we began the course and saying, it's just really hard for me to figure out how to have financial peace and pay my bills without a job and with the mortgage and bills piling up and the need of buying food. COVID was about 2.5 to 3 months old at this point, and you could tell that it was really weighing on this person. Doug, our financial peace leader from the church, mentioned to a couple of us here at the church to try and gather some money. And I want to say to you that this person had not asked or begged or reached out for any financial assistance. But Doug said, you know, maybe we can offer some help. And went to the deacons here at church and pitched in some of his own money and sent that to this person in another state to help out. I remember that next meeting when the person was crying with tears of joy and letting us all know how wonderful this was to help pay some bills and get some groceries and get back on their feet. And they shared with us that they'd been to church that past Sunday for the first time in a long time. Now, that was just money and miracles, and money are not synonymous, but I have no doubt that that person felt that was a miracle. Jesus Christ peeking through, working through other people at the right place and the right time. I have no doubt that people who drive by our blessings box and need something to eat when they can't afford groceries think that that's a miracle. And I want to say as we wrap up today that the authority of Jesus Christ is meant to be obvious to us here in Mark. The way Jesus teaches, the way he drives out the evil spirit, the presence of Christ in our lives, to have authority in our own lives, but also trusting us to be his hands and his feet and to work in his world. I don't know how to answer all the questions and have all the answers about miracles, but I do believe we can be the hands and feet and we can be a miracle to someone. And what better time than now? What better time to go out and reach out in the name of Christ and be a miracle to someone? So this week, may we think, may we pray, may we ask God to reveal how we can be a miracle, and may we ask God to continue to show us how to have authority and how to follow him in our own lives. Amen.
I'm glad you've joined us for this time of worship. We are meeting in person at 11 o'clock on Sunday mornings. The service runs just about 45 minutes. We're following all the safety protocols. We invite you to join us at 11721 Main Street here in historic Middletown. As we go, let's pray together. Our Father, for this time of glad reunion, we give you our genuine thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.